Every employer or indirect employer shall be held responsible with his contractor or subcontractor for any violation of any provision of this labor code. When OWA entered into a contract with Sparkling Clean Manpower Services Incorporated, said government agency lowered its immunity from suit. If OWA can be sued and directed to pay salary differential to workers without budgetary appropriation, OWA.
Start with employer-employee relationship. Labor law is about the employer-employee relationship. Therefore, the applicability of labor laws is dependent upon the existence of an employer-employee relationship. If the relationship is something else other than employer-employee, then the principles of ordinary civil law will apply. Note the tests of employer-employee relationship. You already know this. The first is the economic reality test. When workers possess some attributes of an employee and others of an independent contractor, which make them fall within an intermediate area, they may be classified under the category of employees when the economic facts of the relation make it more nearly one of employment than one of independent business enterprise.
Of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government, and if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment but revision. Now, he would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
created by the sale of that property. Then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the proceeds of the sale. Example, if the entire proceeds of the sale was deposited in the bank, and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary, who is the real owner of the property.
So kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa'yo buo, 1 million. Kasi hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So pang-akit lang yon. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga, ng mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun. Ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be
today to our dear attendees from different parts of the country. I pray that you're all in a great state of health. This free webinar is streaming live via the Villasis Law Center's YouTube channel and Facebook page. If you can hear my voice clearly, please type in the comment section hashtag VLC. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Optimize this learning opportunity. Share this free online lecture to your friends and together learn at the comfort of your homes. I want to formally welcome you all to this free webinar. This part of a series of free online lectures brought to you by the Virtual Law Companion of Villasis Law Center. Allow me to share to you this good news. The Virtual Law Companion is the newest innovation of Villasis Law Center, which aims to provide an easy, convenient, and quality bar review experience. The Virtual Law Companion is a web application that is hosted on a dedicated cloud server. It can be accessed via the internet 24/7 for any web browser, using any device or handheld computers like Android or iOS phones. Meaning, you can study anytime, anywhere, and from any mobile device. Please visit our website at www.villasislawcenter.com to know more about our programs and activities. Before we formally start, please take note of some reminders. First, this free webinar is pre-recorded to ensure the uninterrupted streaming of lectures. Secondly, VLC team will be with you to assist you should you need more information about our program. Please visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel and Facebook page. Without further ado, please give your virtual claps and welcome our lecturer today. Again, this free webinar is brought to you by our Virtual Law Companion. Maraming salamat po. Together, we can make things happen. Together, we can.
Good day, everyone. I am Professor Joseph Ferdinand Dechavez, and welcome to this free online lecture brought to you by the Virtual Law Companion of the Villasis Law Center. Prepare for the bar examinations at any time, anywhere, and from any mobile device. Check out the VLC website at www.villasislawcenter.com for more details and particulars. Optimize this learning opportunity. Like, follow, and subscribe to VLC Facebook page and VLC YouTube channel. Please also share this live stream with your friends and together learn at the comfort of your homes. Before we start, please comment VLC if you can hear me clearly. The topic that we will cover today is the salient features of the Code of Professional Responsibility and Accountability. Before I start, let me give you a brief background of our lecture. You will have to understand that the regulation of the bar is an inherent judicial function. This is based on the fact that we lawyers are officers of the court, and we form part of the machinery of justice. We know that there is a provision in the Constitution, particularly Article 8, Section 5, Paragraph 5, which grants the Supreme Court the power to promulgate rules concerning pleadings, practice, and procedure in all courts. The protection and enforcement of constitutional rights, the regulation of the bar, and legal assistance to the underprivileged. If you will remember, in the case of Henry A. De Leon, the Supreme Court stated that even without this constitutional provision, the regulation of the bar is an inherent judicial function. This is because of the fact, I would like to repeat, that the lawyers are officers of the court, and as such, they form part of the machinery of justice. All right. Recently, particularly on April 11, 2023, the Supreme Court approved the Code of Professional Responsibility and Accountability. On the screen, you will find that the Code of Professional Responsibility has also revised the lawyer's oath. In fact, in its preamble, the code expresses its intent to establish standards for ethical responsibilities that are reflective of the characteristics of the Filipino lawyers and of the influences in the Filipino society, the kind of conduct that our courts, the Constitution, and the laws expect from lawyers as officers of the court, and the ideal qualities that a Filipino lawyer should embody. If you will read the preamble of the Code of Professional Responsibility and Accountability, which we will refer to as CPRA, the preamble has also emphasized that as a source of obligation, the failure of a lawyer to abide by the code or the CPRA will result in the imposition of sanctions. The CPRA consists of six canons. The first canon is independence. Second is propriety. Third is fidelity. Fourth is competence and diligence. Number five, equality. And lastly, accountability. If you will note, the CPRA has codified now not only the ethical responsibilities of lawyers, but the rules and the conduct of administrative disciplinary proceedings and the penalties, therefore, as well. With the approval of the CPRA, the Code of Professional Responsibility of 1988, then Sections 20 to 37 of Rule 138 and Rule 139B of the Rules of Court are thereby repealed. The CPRA has also declared that it shall be applied to all pending and future cases, except to the extent that, in the opinion of the Supreme Court, its retroactive application would not be feasible or would work in justice, in which case the procedure under which the cases were filed shall govern. Let us start with canon number one. Canon number one is independence. Here, the lawyer is expected to be zealous and passionate in pursuing his advocacy or in protecting the interests of his clients. But he should only rely on the merits of his case. He should not try to influence decisions of courts or use other agencies to influence them while he decides on matters of procedure. His client also decides whether to settle or not to settle the case. Under independence, we should be reminded that a lawyer is expected to champion the cause of his client with wholehearted fidelity, care, and devotion. This simply means his client is entitled to the benefit of any and every remedy and defense to protect the interest of his client. In the full discharge of their duties to the client, he shall not be afraid of the possibility that he may displease the general public. Nevertheless, the ethics of our profession provide certain limitations, among others, that the lawyers shall perform their duty to the client within the bounds of the law. They should only make such defense which they believe to be honestly debatable under the law. As officers of the court, lawyers owe their utmost fidelity to public service and the administration of justice. In no way should a lawyer indulge in any act that would damage the image of judges, lest the public's perception of the dispensation of justice be overshadowed by iniquitous doubts. A lawyer should not also allow the client to dictate or determine the procedure in handling the case. Nevertheless, a lawyer shall respect the client's decision in the end to settle or compromise the case after explaining to him its consequences. Canon number two pertains to propriety. Basically, propriety covers the conduct of the lawyer, his language, his treatment of fellow lawyers and of others. For instance, he is expected to be fair and courteous to his fellow lawyers. It also covers the manner by which a lawyer announces his availability to the public. So this canon also covers the matter on solicitation. Let's go to the provisions and rules that are new. So under section 3, if you will note, there is a rule here where the lawyer should not create or promote an unsafe or hostile environment, both in private and public settings, whether online, in workplaces, educational or training institutions, or in recreational areas. To this end, a lawyer shall not commit any form of physical, sexual, psychological, or economic abuse or violence against another person. A lawyer is prohibited from engaging in any gender-based harassment or discrimination. It is the lawyer's duty, we should be reminded, that as a member of the bar, he should abstain from all offensive personality and to advance no fact prejudicial to the honor or reputation of a party or witness unless required by the justice of the cause with which he is charged. A lawyer's language should be forceful but dignified, emphatic but respectful, as befitting an advocate and in keeping with the dignity of the legal profession. Under Section 4, this is a new provision. A lawyer shall only use dignified, gender fair, child, and culturally sensitive language in all personal and professional dealings. To this end, a lawyer shall not use language which is abusive, intemperate, offensive, or otherwise improper, whether oral or written, and whether made through traditional or electronic means, including on all forms of types or types of mass or social media. Similarly, with respect to treatment of witnesses, a lawyer shall avoid all forms of impropriety when presenting or confronting a witness. A lawyer shall not coach, abuse, discriminate against or harass any witness in or out of court, tribunal, or other government agency, or, very important, talk to a witness during a break or recess in the trial while a witness is still under examination. Neither shall a lawyer direct, assist, or abet any misrepresentation or falsehood by a witness. In line with being honest, a lawyer shall not make false representations or statements. A lawyer shall not, when making or addressing a demand letters or other similar correspondence, make false representation or statements. If you will note, under this provision, the CPRA added a liability for a lawyer in case he is found to have committed false representations or statements in that will result in damage or injury to another person. It specifically states that a lawyer shall be liable for any material damage caused by such false representations or statements. He is also required to correct false or inaccurate statements and information made in relation to an application for admission to the bar, any pleading or any other document required by or submitted to the court, tribunal, or agency as soon as its falsity or inaccuracy is discovered or made known to him or her. There is also a duty now under the CPRA for the lawyer to report to the appropriate authority any transaction or unlawful activity that is required to be reported under relevant laws, including the submission of covered and suspicious transactions under regulatory laws, such as those concerning anti-money laundering. The duty of confidentiality cannot be used here as an excuse. If you will note, if a law is being violated, the lawyer's duty of confidentiality cannot be used as a basis not to disclose or report to the authorities of a perceived illegal act that will be committed or is being committed. Under this provision, when disclosing or reporting the foregoing information to the appropriate court, tribunal, or other government agency, the lawyer shall not be deemed to have violated the lawyer's duty of confidentiality. In addition to this, under Section 16, a lawyer, is given the duty to report life-threatening situations. A lawyer who has reasonable grounds to believe that a life-threatening situation is likely to develop in relation to any proceeding in any court, tribunal, or other government agency shall immediately report the same to the proper authorities. Thus, even when a lawyer is bound by his duty of confidentiality, if in the course of handling his client's case, he comes across upon information of a crime about to be committed by his client or by some other persons, the lawyer has the duty to report the same to the police authorities in order to prevent the commission of such crime. With respect to the on the matter of non-solicitation and impermissible advertisement, here there is a new provision which states that a lawyer, a law firm, or any of their representatives shall not pay or give any benefit or consideration to any media, practitioner, award-giving body, professional organization, or personality in anticipation of or in return for publicity or recognition to attract legal representation, service, or retainership. In addition, this is again a new provision under Section 18. A lawyer now is prohibited from making public appearances to give statements in relation to a terminated case or legal matter for the purpose of self-promotion, self-aggrandizement, or to seek public sympathy. Previously, the rule is when a decision has already been rendered and the case has become final and executory, it is already thrown to the public for public consumption, criticism, and lawyers can discuss the merits of that case publicly. This case pertains to the lawyer who has probably handled the case. He cannot make public appearances and make statements even with respect to a terminated case or legal matter if his purpose is to promote himself or to seek public sympathy or self-aggrandizement. This is in relation to the rule on sub judice, where a lawyer should not use any forum or medium to comment or publicize opinion. If that will have the effect of causing a prejudgment or sway public perception or impute improper motives or create a widespread perception of guilt or innocence before final decision. If you will note, let me clarify, the earlier provision that we talk about refers to a case which is already terminated, whereas the general rule on sub judice pertains to pending cases. So under the sub judice rule, it restricts comments and disclosure pertaining to judicial proceedings to avoid prejudging the issue, influencing the court, or obstructing the administration of justice. If you will note, under the rules of court, a violation of the sub judice rule may render one liable for indirect contempt of the court. The rationale for the rule adverted to is set out in the case of Nestle Philippines versus Sanchez, where the Supreme Court stated that it is the traditional conviction of civil society everywhere that courts in the decision of issues of fact and law should be immune from every extraneous influence The facts should be decided based on the evidence produced in court, and that the determination of such facts should be uninfluenced by bias, prejudice, or sympathies. Under Section 20, there is now a rule which requires a lawyer at the first available opportunity to formally disclose on record his relationship or connection, if any, with the presiding officer of any court, tribunal, or agency, or any of its personnel or lawyers, partners, associates, or clients that may serve as a ground for mandatory inhibition in any pending proceeding before such court, tribunal, or other government agency. If you will note, under the rules of court, a judge or judicial officer shall be mandatorily disqualified to sit in any case in which he is related to either party within the sixth degree of consanguinity or affinity, or to counsel within the fourth degree, computed according to the rules of civil law. In addition, the rules also provide on the so-called voluntary inhibition, in which the judge may, in the exercise of his sound discretion, disqualify himself from sitting in a case for just or valid reasons other than those just mentioned. There is also a clear and categorical prohibition now against gift giving and donations. The provision specifically states that a lawyer shall not directly or indirectly give gifts, donations, contributions of any value or sort on any occasion to any court, tribunal, or government agency, or any of its officers and personnel. This one clarifies the cases whereby the Supreme Court previously rendered decision providing that if the lawyer is employed in the government, generally speaking, the Integrated Bar of the Philippines does not have jurisdiction to investigate him. Under this new provision, lawyers in the government shall observe the standard of conduct under the CPRA, the Code of Conduct and Ethical Standards for Public Officials and Employees, and other related laws and issuances in the performance of their duties. According to this provision, in addition, any violation of the CPRA by lawyers in the government service shall be subject to disciplinary action separate and distinct from liability under pertinent laws and rules. Previously, in these cases, the cases of Buff versus Gonzalez, Alicias versus Makatangay, Trovella versus Robles, Segura versus Pabila, and the IBP has no jurisdiction over government lawyers who are charged with administrative offenses involving their official duties. However, in the case of Pilipel versus Avila, the Supreme Court clarified that a lawyer holding a public office does not deprive the Supreme Court of jurisdiction to discipline and impose penalties upon him or her for an ethical conduct. On the contrary, according to the Supreme Court, holding public office amplifies a lawyer's disciplinary liability. Here, the respondent was entrapped at the Barrio Fiesta restaurant, receiving protection money that he demanded from complainant. In other words, he may be disciplined by his office, but at the same time, if his misconduct constituted as violations of the CPRA, he may again be disciplined under the provisions of the CPRA by the IBP or the Supreme Court. So this is now the rule. When a complaint is filed against a government lawyer, you will note when the respondent is a government lawyer, the rules under accountability is to the effect that the verified complaint may only be filed before the Supreme Court. So that when a complaint is filed against a government lawyer, the investigating commissioner shall determine within 5 days from assignment by raffle whether the concerned agency, the ombudsman, or the Supreme Court has jurisdiction. If the allegations in the complaint touch upon the lawyer's continuing obligations under the CPRA, or if the allegations assuming them to be true make the lawyer unfit to practice the profession, then the investigating commissioner shall proceed with the case. Otherwise, the investigating commissioner shall recommend that the complaint be dismissed. We also have new provisions pertaining to lawyers in the academe. So lawyers in the academe may be serving as dean, administrative officer, or faculty member of the law school or educational institution. They are also required to adhere to the standards of behavior required of members of the legal profession, including the rules on conflict of interest, the lawyers on lawyers' duty of confidentiality. This is clarified actually in the case of Cayetano versus Monsod and in the letter of the UP Law Faculty entitled Restoring Integrity. In those cases, the Supreme Court held that lawyers who are also law professors are, although guaranteed academic freedom and indisputably they are free to determine what they will teach their students and how they will teach these students. However, according to the Supreme Court, it is not inconsistent with the principle of academic freedom for the court to subject lawyers who teach law to disciplinary action for contumacious conduct and speech coupled with undue intervention in favor of a party in a pending case without observing proper procedure, even if purportedly done in their capacity as teachers. In the case of Cayetano versus Monsod, the Supreme Court elucidated that unlike professors in other disciplines and more than lawyers who do not teach law, professors of law are bound by their oath to uphold the ethical standards of the legal profession. We also have a rule now pertaining to paralegal services and the lawyer's responsibility over them. Under this provision, a paralegal is one who performs tasks that require familiarity with legal concepts. But while they assist the work of lawyers, they perform non-diagnostic and non-advisory work in relation to the legal matters delegated to them by the lawyers. According to this provision, a lawyer must direct or supervise a paralegal in the performance of the latter's delegated duties, and the lawyer's duty of confidentiality shall also extend to services rendered by the paralegal who is equally bound to keep the privilege. These are, again, new provisions pertaining to the responsibility and use of lawyer of the social media, digital communication, under this provision, a lawyer shall have the duty to understand the benefits, risk, and ethical implications associated with the use of social media. In the case of Velasco versus Causing, the Supreme Court said that a lawyer is not allowed to divide his personality as an attorney at one time and a mere citizen at another, regardless of whether a lawyer is representing his client in court or acting as a supposed spokesperson outside the pit, or is merely practicing his right to press freedom as a blogger, his duties to the society and his ethical obligations as a member of the bar remain unchanged. So, for instance, there is a provision here which provides that a lawyer shall not knowingly or maliciously post, share, upload, or otherwise disseminate false or unverified statements, claims, or commit any other act of disinformation. A lawyer shall not also create, maintain, or operate accounts in social media to hide his or her identity for the purpose of circumventing the law or the provisions of the CPRA. A lawyer shall ensure that his or her online post, whether made in a public or restricted privacy setting, that still holds an audience, uphold the dignity of the legal profession and shield it from disrepute, as well as maintain respect for the law. A lawyer has also an obligation not to disclose privileged information through online post. A lawyer shall not reveal directly or indirectly in his or her online post confidential information obtained from a client or in the course of or emanating from the representation, except when allowed by law or the CPRA. In this regard, Section 41 also provides that a lawyer who uses a social media account to communicate with any other person in relation to clients' confidences and information shall exert efforts to prevent the inadvertent or unauthorized disclosure or use of or unauthorized access to such account. A lawyer should not communicate, whether directly or indirectly, with an officer of any court, tribunal, or other government agency through social media to influence the latter's performance of official duties. We have to be careful of this. Then lastly, whenever a lawyer gives advice through traditional or electronic means in all forms of types of mass or social media, he has a responsibility. He shall be bound by the duties of a lawyer under the CPRA in relation to such limited legal service. And that a lawyer shall exercise prudence in making posts or comments in social media that could violate the provisions on conflict of interest under the CPRA. In the case of Food Sphere versus Mauricio, the Supreme Court emphasized the necessity for every lawyer to act and comport himself in a manner that promotes public confidence in the integrity of the profession. Here, the respondent engaged in deceitful conduct by taking advantage of the complaint against the complainant to advance his interests to obtain funds by using his media platform to attack the product of the complainant. Let's move on to canon number 3. Canon 3 talks about fidelity. This refers to the obligation of the lawyer to his client. To use every available means, provided it is consistent with truth and honor. So there is a new provision pertaining to the responsibility of a lawyer over a subordinate lawyer, a paralegal, or employee. Under Section 10, a lawyer or law firm shall be responsible now for the mistakes, negligence, and or acts or omissions of a subordinate lawyer, paralegal, or employee under the lawyer's direct supervision and control, who is acting within the scope of the assigned task that cause damage or injury which brings dishonor to the profession or violates the rule on confidentiality. This is the doctrine of imputed liability. As a general rule, one is only responsible for his own act or omission. However, a person may be held liable under quasi-delict. It provides for certain exception when certain persons may be held liable for acts or omissions of another. One exception is an employer who is made vicariously liable for the tort committed by his employee. The second paragraph, however, provides for the application of the principle of bonus pater familia. Here, the liability of the supervising lawyer will not attach if he is able to prove that he exercised diligence of a good parent of a family in the selection and supervision of subordinate lawyer, paralegal, or employee. Similarly, under Section 40, the CPRA provides for the accountability of a legal clinic director and the supervising lawyer in the legal clinic. A law student clinic director and supervising lawyer under Rule 138A of the Rules of Court shall provide meaningful training to law students. They shall also assume responsibility for any work performed by such law students while under their supervision and shall comply with all the laws, rules, and guidelines pertaining to law student practice. Likewise, under the Canon on Fidelity, under Section 15, when a lawyer joins a law firm, it is his duty to disclose to the law firm at the earliest possible opportunity his or her previous clients that may have a potential conflict of interest with the current clients of the law firm. If there is a potential conflict of interest, the lawyer shall not act on the case or cases of the affected current client. If you will note, we have the rule on imputed disqualification, where an associate or a partner of a firm will be disqualified by under the rules on conflict of interest if another associate or partner, even if they are not, they have not participated in the handling of that case, for as long as the case is being handled by the firm. This is a new provision, Section 16. Prohibition against dating, romantic, or sexual relations with a client. A lawyer shall not have dating, romantic, or sexual relations with a client during the engagement unless the consensual relationship existed between them before the lawyer-client relationship commenced. Attorney-client sexual relations are improper, we will have to realize, because they diminish professionalism and invite lawyers to abuse their position of power. In the case of Benson versus Peleo, Benson and the respondent first met, in which the latter was Benson's counsel in the handling of her petition for declaration of nullity of her marriage with her husband. Respondent was also married. The two got close to one another and the respondent exerted effort to gain her trust. By the time the judicial decree of annulment of her marriage came out, they were already in a serious relationship. Clearly, squarely, this falls under the prohibition under this new rule. We also have a new rule with respect to legal services organization and conflict of interest. Under this rule, a legal services organization is any private organization, including a legal aid clinic, a partnership, an association, or corporation whose primary purpose is to provide free legal services. A lawyer-client relationship shall arise only between the client and the handling lawyers of the legal services organization. All the lawyers of the legal services organization who participated in the handling of a legal matter shall be covered by the rule on conflict of interest and confidentiality. This is the controversial provision which recently the public attorney's office brought before the Supreme Court. Unfortunately, it also came out in the social media. Under Section 22, with respect to the public attorney's office, a public attorney's office is similar to a legal services organization. The public attorney's office is the primary legal aid service office of the government. In the pursuit of its mandate under its charter, the public attorney's office shall ensure ready access to its services by the marginalized sector of society in a manner that takes into consideration the avoidance of potential conflict of interest situations, which will leave these marginalized parties unassisted by counsel. A conflict of interest under this provision, a conflict of interest of any lawyers of the public attorney's office incident to services rendered for the office shall be imputed only to the said lawyer and the lawyer's direct supervisor. Such conflict of interest, therefore, will not disqualify the rest of the lawyers from the public attorney's office from representing the affected client upon full disclosure to the latter of the written informed consent. The position of the public attorney's office is to the effect that if they are, or if the lawyer of the public attorney's office is already representing a particular litigant in a case, the adverse or the opposing party cannot anymore be represented by the public attorney's office. Under this provision, that opposing party may still be represented by the public attorney's office, and the conflict of interest, therefore, will not disqualify them, except the lawyer handling the other party and the supervising, and or rather his direct supervisor. There is also a requirement now that a lawyer shall assist the integrated bar of the Philippines, the law schools, law alumni associations, law associations or civic organizations in educating the public on the law and jurisprudence. Previously, the rule is limited to the lawyer's responsibility in keeping abreast with legal developments and to participate in the continuing legal education. Now, in view of the fact that the various chapters of the IPP are maintaining legal aid and requiring supervising lawyers to legal aid clinics and the various law schools and law associations, there is now a need for lawyers to be required to assist these legal services organizations. There is also a requirement for a lawyer in order to prepare the next generation of lawyers for ethical practice that lawyers should support legal internship and apprenticeship programs and accept law students for training in the lawyer's firm, law office, legal aid clinic. The lawyer shall treat the apprentices as junior colleagues and future counsels and shall conscientiously supervise them. This is also a new provision. While our constitution provides that the practice of law in the Philippines is limited to Filipino citizens, the CPRA found the need to categorically include in the CPRA a provision stating that foreign lawyers cannot directly or indirectly practice law in the Philippines. When providing for limited legal service, limited legal services refer to services for a specific legal incident, with the expectation by the lawyer and the client that the lawyer will not provide continuing legal services in the matter, there is a requirement that in all instances, the lawyer should clearly state that the service being rendered by him is in the nature of limited legal services. Limited legal services includes being appointed as counsel de officio for arraignment purposes or special appearances, to make court submissions, to give advice, to draft legal documents, to provide legal assistance before courts or administrative bodies and the like. Note that when a lawyer is appointed as a counsel de officio, he cannot simply refuse and use as a ground conflict of interest. Instead, the lawyer shall disclose to all affected parties such conflict of interest. Even a lawyer serving in the government shall not be exempt from pro bono service and may be appointed as a counsel de officio. Canon 4, competence and diligence. There is only one provision that I would like to discuss here with respect to non-legal activities. Under Section 10 of the CPRA on Canon 4 on competence and diligence, a lawyer who is engaged in business or non-legal profession shall also be required to observe the ethical duties and responsibilities of a lawyer under the CPRA. If you will remember the case of Cayetano versus Monsod, the Supreme Court stated that Attorney Monsod's past experiences as lawyer economist, lawyer manager, or lawyer entrepreneur of industry, a lawyer negotiator of contracts, and a lawyer legislator of both the rich and the poor barely qualifies as practice of law. On equality, Canon 5, there are important provisions here that the CPRA would like to pound upon us lawyers, especially with respect to treatment of vulnerable persons. In dealing with a client who belongs to a vulnerable sector, a lawyer shall be mindful and sensitive of and consider the client's special circumstances as well as the applicable laws and rules. This one is new. The lawyer shall observe a higher standard of service suited to a particular to the particular needs of the vulnerable person and shall assert such person's right to meaningful access to justice. Who is a vulnerable person? A vulnerable person is a person who is at a higher risk of harm than others and shall include children, the elderly, the homeless, persons with disability, persons deprived of liberty, human rights victims, victims of domestic violence, victims of armed conflict, those who are socioeconomically disadvantaged, those who belong to racial or ethnic minorities, or those with debilitating physical or mental conditions. Let me repeat. Under Section 4, a lawyer shall observe, generally speaking, the same standard for all clients regardless of remuneration, whether pro bono or de parte or paying clients. However, under this canon provides for exception, except for higher standard required for representation of vulnerable persons. Then lastly, on Canon 6, accountability, under the CPRA, proceedings for disbarment, suspension, or discipline of lawyers may be commenced by the Supreme Court on its own initiative or motu proprio, or upon the filing of a verified complaint by the Board of Governors of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. This is a new provision, or by any person before the Supreme Court or the IBP. However, a verified complaint against a government lawyer which seeks to discipline such lawyer as a member of the bar shall only be filed in the Supreme Court. On the investigation under the CPRA, upon joinder of issues or upon failure of the respondent to answer, the investigating commissioner shall proceed with the investigation of the case. However, if despite reasonable notice, the respondent fails to file an answer or appear, The investigation shall proceed ex parte. In both instances, the investigation shall proceed with dispatch. This one is important provision. The next paragraph. The respondent shall be given full opportunity to defend and be heard, whether through counsel or not, and to present witnesses. If you will remember, in the case of Ilaya versus Gakot, the Supreme Court enunciated that the conduct of formal investigation is not mandatory in the administrative disciplinary action against lawyers. In other words, the lawyer cannot demand the conduct of administrative investigation. Under the CPRA, however, it appears that the conduct of formal investigation may now be requested by the respondent. Under this provision, the respondent should be given full opportunity to defend and be heard, whether through counsel or not, and to present witnesses. The investigating commissioner shall also have the power to issue subpoena and administer oaths and affirmations in relation to the conduct of the proceedings. This one is very important for us to take into consideration. Under Section 16 of CPRA, no investigation shall be interrupted or terminated by reason of the desistance, settlement, compromise, restitution, withdrawal of the charges, or failure of the complainant to prosecute the same. In other words, despite the fact that the complainant has withdrawn his complaint or has desisted therefrom, the complaint may still proceed and the investigating commissioner may still continue with his investigation. We discussed this earlier with respect to a government lawyer. Previously, under this rule, the IBP, as declared by the Supreme Court, has no jurisdiction over government lawyers who are charged with administrative offenses involving their official duties. However, as explained in the case of Pilipel versus Avila, a lawyer's holding public office does not deprive the Supreme Court of jurisdiction to discipline and impose penalties upon him or her for an ethical conduct. On the contrary, holding public office amplifies a lawyer's disciplinary liability. So that when a complaint is filed against a government lawyer, the investigating commissioner shall determine within 5 days from assignment by raffle whether the concerned agency, the ombudsman, or the Supreme Court has jurisdiction. If the allegations in the complaint touch upon the lawyer's continuing obligations under the CPRA, or if the allegations, assuming them to be true, make the lawyer unfit to practice the profession, then the investigating commissioner shall proceed with the case. Otherwise, the investigating commissioner shall recommend that the complaint shall be dismissed. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.
Together we can.
Every employer or indirect employer shall be held responsible with his contractor or subcontractor for any violation of any provision of this labor code. When OWA entered into a contract with Sparkling Clean Manpower Services Incorporated, said government agency lowered its immunity from suit. If OWA can be sued and directed to pay salary differential to workers without budgetary appropriation, OWA.
Start with employer-employee relationship. Labor law is about the employer-employee relationship. Therefore, the applicability of labor laws is dependent upon the existence of an employer-employee relationship. If the relationship is something else other than employer-employee, then the principles of ordinary civil law will apply. Note the tests of employer-employee relationship. You already know this. The first is the economic reality test. When workers possess some attributes of an employee and others of an independent contractor, which make them fall within an intermediate area, they may be classified under the category of employees when the economic facts of the relation make it more nearly one of employment than one of independent business enterprise.
Members of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment but revision. Now, you would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
benefited by the sale of that property. Then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the process of the sale. Example, if the entire process of the sale was deposited in the bank, and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary, who is the real owner of the property.
So kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor, basta ibibigay sa iyo buo 1 million. Kasi hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So pang-akit lang yon, pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun. Ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable.
Every employer or indirect employer shall be held responsible with his contractor or subcontractor for any violation of any provision of this labor code. When OWA entered into a contract with Sparkling Clean Manpower Services Incorporated, said government agency lowered its immunity from suit. If OWA can be sued and directed to pay salary differential to workers without budgetary appropriation, OWA.
Start with employer-employee relationship. Labor law is about the employer-employee relationship. Therefore, the applicability of labor laws is dependent upon the existence of an employer-employee relationship. If the relationship is something else other than employer-employee, then the principles of ordinary civil law will apply. Note the tests of employer-employee relationship. You already know this. The first is the economic reality test. When workers possess some attributes of an employee and others of an independent contractor, which make them fall within an intermediate area, they may be classified under the category of employees when the economic facts of the relation make it more nearly one of employment than one of independent business enterprise.
Of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment but revision. Now, you would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
By the sale of that property, then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the proceeds of the sale. Example, if the entire proceeds of the sale was deposited in the bank and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary who is the real owner of it.
So kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa iyo buo, 1 million. Kasi hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So pang-akit lang yun. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga ng mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun, ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable.
Members of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment but revision. Now, you would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
By the sale of that property, then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the process of the sale. Example, if the entire proceeds of the sale was deposited in the bank and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary who is the real owner of
So, kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa'yo buo, 1 million. Kasi, hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So, pang-akit lang yon. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga ng mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun. Ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable.
Members of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment but revision. Now, he would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
By the sale of that property, then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the proceeds of the sale. Example, if the entire proceeds of the sale was deposited in the bank, and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary, who is the real owner of the property.
So kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa'yo buo, 1 million. Kasi hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So pang-akit lang yon. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun. Ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable. We'll be right back.
of the parliament are also members of the cabinet. And it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay? That is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles. That is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment, but revision. Now, you would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
By the sale of that property, then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the process of the sale. Example, if the entire process of the sale was deposited in the bank and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary who is the real owner of the property.
So kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa iyo buo, 1 million. Kasi hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So pang-akit lang yon. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga, ng mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun. Ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable.
Members of the parliament are also members of the cabinet, and it is the parliament who elects the government. Okay, that is basically a parliamentary form of government. And if that is the case, you only have to change two articles, that is Article 6 and Article 7 of the Constitution. But despite that, applying the qualitative test, the impact of the change on the Constitution, we would say that the change that is effected is not only amendment, but revision. Now, you would ask, Judge, why would it be necessary for us to know the distinction? Okay.
By the sale of that property, then if we can follow that property in all its state and form, if the beneficiary, the real owner, can follow that particular property to the changes, through all the changes in its state and form, or even if you can no longer follow that particular property, but you can still identify the proceeds of the sale. Example, if the entire proceeds of the sale was deposited in the bank, and you can identify the amount and the deposit itself. Therefore, equity will pursue the property or the proceeds of the property. We can have restitution of the property to the beneficiary, who is the real owner of
So, kung may tax man, babayaran ng sponsor. Basta ibibigay sa'yo buo, 1 million. Kasi, hindi mo naman pwede mag-grant ng tax exemption ang Joey De Leon at saka ang GMA. Okay? So, pang-akit lang yon. Pero taxable pa rin yung mga yan. Kaya lang yung tax, hindi na ipapasa doon sa recipient. Sasaluhin na yan yung mga, ng mga sponsor, ng mga employer, ganun yun, ano? Okay, so that is the optional retirement benefits. Now, take note of this. You have to remember this. Optional retirement benefit is exempt only once. Once only. If you happen to receive two or three, the others will be taxable. The first one will be exempt, but all the others will be taxable.